Good evening, St. James. Welcome to my dining room. It's Monday evening. It's 8 o'clock. Let's meet for evening worship. Let's meet for some prayer, some Bible reading, and some singing. I'm going to pray before we start, so let's pray. Father God, thank you for this evening. Thank you that you are here with us now. Thank you that as the night draws in and the darkness settles, that you are the light. Father, help us to take a bigger glimpse of your light this evening, to know you more, to be made more like you. Amen. As we worship this evening, we're going to start by singing a song by Phil Whitman called Great Things, and then we'll see where we go from there.
Come, let us worship the King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See what His love overcome. He has done great. And hallelujah, God,
Thank you that you are always near. You make us the people who are aware of you. Have you thought about common spirit? Singing. Only you. Jesus, would you fill us with your spirit until everything around us falls away and it's only you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And we lift our hands and we bow our knees and we pray, come Holy Spirit, strip away anything that's not of you and bring us to that place of devotion, of love, of surrender. Bring us to that place where it's only you, Jesus. Only you can get us through this. Only you can heal our land. And as we turn to you, Father, and as we say, you and you only, heal our land. Heal it from the effects of it abandoning you. Heal it from its sickness. Heal it from its disease. Heal it from its chains. Heal it from its idolatry. Heal it from its lostness. Its feeling of abandon. Your name is so powerful. You can do anything. You have done. One with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is. Beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Father, thank you for your truth. You were there at the beginning, you were there at the end, and you will be there at our end, and you will be there at the end. You are the Alpha and Omega. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. There is no boast that you cannot. Let's read our Bibles. Right, our reading today is from John. It's the resurrection tomb. So it is John 20, verses 1 to 10. And the Church of England doesn't just do Easter on Easter Sunday. It has a season of Easter, just like we had a season of Lent. And so we don't just get to hear the resurrection story on Easter Sunday. We get to hear it for the next month or so after. So we're reading John 20, 1 to 10. And I'm reading it from the Evening Prayer app, which is called Daily Prayer, and it's from the Church of England. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to summon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. This story reminds me of Lazarus. When Lazarus came out from his tomb, he was wrapped in cloths and somebody had to unwrap him. Jesus, when he rose from the dead, it seems he unwrapped himself. His wrappings were in two different places. His body wrappings were just on the floor, lying there. And the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So his body wrappings came off, but his head wrappings he took off and he rolled them up and he put them by himself, by themselves. Now, a carpenter, when he finishes his job, he takes off his wrappings that held his hair away from his hammer and he rolls them up and he puts them away. Same way as a builder, when they come off a building site, they take off their helmet and they put it away. It's done for, it's not necessary. A cook takes off their apron and rolls it up. It is finished, the work is done. Often, whenever we meet as clergy together, the high church clergy, they wear stoles with a cross at the back. And when they're putting them on, they kiss the cross and they put it on. And then they do the service, and then when they come to the end of the service, they take it off and they kiss it again, and then they put it down. Service is done. It is finished. And here we find in the tomb where Jesus' body was laid, he is taken off his head garment himself. He has rolled it up as a carpenter would, and he's laid it down. It is finished. My work is complete. I love that when he finishes his ministry on earth, his dying and his rising, he includes in that his carpentry. He includes in that his day-to-day living before he was 30, before he got baptized. It is done, everything. He's still following his heavenly Father and his earthly Father. It is finished. The two disciples, they come in, they saw and they believed. What our reading doesn't tell us is what they believed. What did they believe? Were they believing that that Jesus had risen from the dead? I think it's much more everyday than that, as usual and normal. I think they're believing that the body wasn't there. I think they're believing Mary Magdalene, that someone's taken the body. For as yet, they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And so they went home. It's this weird time where, as far as Jesus is concerned, it is finished. Death is beaten. Resurrection has happened. His life as a carpenter, his life as a prophet, his life as a teacher, his life is done. His next chapter has started. But his disciples are still living in the Saturday. Jesus has died, but he is not yet conquering here. They are still in, they don't understand. No one's told them, it's not their fault. But they don't understand. So Jesus is in one place and they are in another. I think sometimes it's like that for us as a church. Jesus is sat there going, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. If you have nothing but you have me, you have everything. If you have no health but you have me, you have everything. If you have no job but you have me, you have everything. Every possibility is open to you. And we know that the grave is empty and that the tomb is gone and the stone is rolled away, but we haven't yet totally grasped what that means. We live in our disappointment time, which we're happy to bring up and remember. And not in the resurrection reality. So we want church to grow and we want to see God move, but we don't want it to be too scary or too risky because we might go back to disappointment. We might discover that actually the body was stolen. But Jesus is firmly risen. He has folded up his carpenter's hat. He has put away his apron. He is done. All work now is through us. To be in the Saturday is gloomier, but somehow sometimes it feels safer. You don't have to risk anything. You can just wait. But in Christ, we can do amazing things because he fills us with his Spirit. We are children of resurrection. We are children of God. We are resurrection, life after death people, life now people. There is no curse too strong. We cannot break it in his power. There is no sickness so deep. We cannot heal it in his power. There is no sermon so terrifying we cannot preach it in his power. No prayer so faithful that we cannot preach it in his power. There is no one so unlovely that we cannot love them in his power. So my prayer for us today is that we would be resurrection people. That we as a church, as we join together every night at 8 o'clock, would become more and more risk takers because we have nothing to lose. We would become more and more people who know that first and foremost we are children of God, that we are loved, that we are secure, that we are powerful because Jesus' carpenter's hat was folded. It is done. Death is beaten. I'm going to pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you rose from the dead and you folded up your carpenter's hat. Thank you that you made for us a way. We are resurrection people. And Jesus, I am sorry. We are sorry for when we as a church have tried to add things to you. I want Jesus and help. Jesus and my own pride. Jesus and I can do it myself. I do things myself. Jesus and sustainability. Jesus and. Father, we sang tonight, it's only you. It's only you. Sifuteliim, it's only you. And so, Father, help us in this time to strip away everything that holds us back from knowing that we are Easter people, we are resurrection people. And Father, as resurrection people, and as your death and risen from the dead, knowing and believing, we pray coronavirus to the grave. We pray this great sickness to the grave. Thank you, Father, that you bring light and goodness and love even out of this time. But you have conquered death and you have conquered sickness. We pray for our doctors and nurses in this current situation where they are not safe to work. Give them wisdom and courage. Father, thank you that you are with them and you are working through them and you are giving them comfort and strength. Thank you that you are in them as they treat those who are sick. Jesus, you are so good to us. We pray for those who are grieving, that you would be their strength and their light. They would know your stillness and your joy. And we pray for ourselves tonight, as the evening draws in, may we have you as the apple of our eyes. May we have you as our one true God. I don't pray for health or money or comfortable. I pray for you, Father, more of you in us this evening. Would you fill us with your Spirit? May our faith be our shield, but not for us. Pray more of you, Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let's pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. So we go into our evening with a prayer. May the risen Christ grant us the joys of eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Night, night, St. James.